And I remember, of course, you know, when we had inquiries in the past into the failures and allegations around corruption and the failure to disclose interests all around the Booth estate and what happened there. Councillor Radford, myself and other councillors were denied the opportunity to ask open and honest questions. But we all know, and I keep reminding people, what happened with the Councillor Kempy, who was chased out of the city by the then administration and David Henshaw. He went missing for 4 years. I remember him skulking into the back of that 8:45 before the council meeting just to get his little ticks. But I remember all those days. And it's important that we remember when we're talking about this particular site in Great George's Street, who sold it, okay? In 2004, it was sold by the Liberal Democrats to Aaron Splash, and it was called the Tribeca Scheme. It was stalled. It was stalled indeed beyond 2014. And what we tried to do was unlock it and get it moving. There was all kinds of things that happened. Things went wrong. Your houses were involved with Aaron Splash, and it went wrong. And we owned some parts of that site. If you look at it, the site into three parts, A, B and C. C was sold by Aaron Splash to North Point Global. We owned the middle part, B, and C was done on a deal with them. As long as they delivered on phase one, we would let them have phase two. Of course, they haven't delivered on phase one, so we will make sure that we hold those two pieces of land. And the reality is that Aaron Splash and North Point Global did a deal that sold that piece of land. They were actually the biggest sort of bidder, and Aaron Splash, rightly so, were able to sell that particular piece of land on one private sector company to another private sector company. But what we've done and what we've pledged to do, because the very idea that we can intervene or do due diligence on a private company selling to another private company is just a nonsense, and we can't. What we can do is do due diligence when we work with somebody. But of course the things that we can learn from the process, and of course the things that we can do and we will do. But we'll take no lessons from the Lib Dems, who actually sold the site in 2004 and then left it there for us to pick up and try and deal with. In the same way you deal with Project Jennifer, in the same way with Ed's Lane, and the same way with many other things in this city. But what we will try to do, and there's a lot of interest in the site, we've got 12 expressions of interest in talking to us about that site. We will actually try to see if we can use the land that we've retained, the land that hasn't been given over to them, to see if we can work out an arrangement that helps those that have been stoned. And not instead of, you know, people attacking this city for that, they should be attacking the agencies that sold them to the vulnerable people in Hong Kong or wherever, or who bought them. They're the ones that should have done the due diligence, not Liverpool City Council. So go and attack those agencies that sold those properties to the people in China or whatever it else that they bought them. But we will do all we can, everything we can, not only to hold that company to account, but to try to assist to see if we can help those people that have been duped and that have been conned. And of course that also means that I noticed there's a question from Councillor Radford and his colleague around the Carlton Cinema site, which they own. We're looking at what we can do with those sites as well in terms of dealing with them and working with them. So it's important really that people get the right information and the right detail. And of course, we see, what's going on in terms of from the Liberal Democrats trying to blame us. But we will remind people, of course, of what they did. And it's the same approach that Councillor Kemp tries with his blogs and stuff around the chief executive or whatever it is to try and stir up and create this myth of something of a crisis going on. Well, there's £1.4 billion worth of private sector development planned over the next 2 years and more jobs to be created. So we're in no crisis and we're in no panic and we've not listened to you or we won't listen to the people outside that tell us to change direction. We're in the right direction, dealing with austerity, dealing with our cuts and making our city a better place to live. And I also just want to be slightly slow in getting to my feet, and that's because I was looking at an app, it's an anagram app, and I look at it because it's one of those things as you get older, you've got to try and keep your brain active and stuff. It's an anagram app, and I was looking at it, and you type a name in, and you see what words you can come up with. And I typed in Joe Anderson, and I'm working out what it says. It actually says for Joe Anderson, one rose ale a J.A. That's what it says in my drinking days. And then I typed in Richard Kemp, and it said, Mr. I typed in Richard Kemp, and it says, Mr. Ed. Now there's five letters missing. One's a R, one's a K, one's a P, one's an I, and one's a C. So I want you to try and weigh it down. Weigh down what you think it would be and send your answers to me. Happy to take any questions, wasn't it?
Look, I just need to say one thing before we go any further than that. There's comments in relating to the chief executive part of the comments made by the mayor. And that is to state, in view of the comments made by the mayor, I'm not going to take any specific questions on that matter in this public meeting. If members do not have any questions, can they please, on that matter, can they please send them directly with the city solicitor? Of course, there were another items that were raised, and at times other members were raised, were mentioned in the comments, so I will allow those people to respond. Councillor Bradford had his hand up first, and then Councillor Kemp, vice warden, I'll call Councillor Kemp for
Councillor. I appreciate your direction over questions on Chief Executive. Can I just make one positive comment, which I don't think will be needed to the council anyway. We did receive a briefing at 2:30 this afternoon. I'm grateful to the mayor for that briefing, and grateful for the assurance that all parties will be prepared access to the legal advice council as it proceeds. So, just a personal thank you. I acknowledge that. I think that was a constructive dialogue this afternoon, certainly as far as the Liberal Party group is concerned. The only other comment I'd ask is that. Whilst you refer to the panel looking at reputational damage, I think in that dialogue we did discuss that you might wish to look at any broad and material impact from the Liberal. So that's just a comment.
I was going to grab you very quickly and say no further comments on this matter.
Yes, there is, my lord mayor. That was purely to be helpful because the public statement was narrower than the dialogue previous. On Global North Point, I understand it was one of the owners of the Carlton site. We understand that one of the known directors of the company has now repurchased it with another company name, a scenario that's not happened. Has happened before at a lower price, and the architects now have been left out paying. That you said the council isn't responsible in any way, I just ask you to bear in mind the council was, in a photograph by yourself, deemed as partners of the site and publicised in 2012, having sorted the site out, coming to Labour's chamber. So the council has a linkage, and the council has had an impact for your own office. On the site, but I would clarify that we understand, and if it's different, I would appreciate the advice that the company had disinvested at that particular site to put to partners in the broad sense of the word, a director who was previously involved with the previous directors but under a different company name.
Yeah, look, I've written to Council on occasions over this and reiterate the point is what we said and what we did at that time was did in good faith. There is absolutely no way that we would have given any sort of approval or support to any company that we believe would then leave, for instance, that particular site in the way it is. And that's why we're working to look at other avenues to actually bring that to a close. And I can give you my top assurance that that's exactly what we will do. Well, maybe just forgive me for 1 minute, because I did omit to mention something in my report, and that is I raised an issue with regards to Emily has been promoted, Emily's been promoted to the PCC, assistant PCC, and she leaves that cabinet position. With a cabinet position vacant. And one of the things that I've been concerned about over many years is the way disability in not just in the country but in the city has been given, if you like, played second fiddle. It's a Cinderella issue. And we've got to address that, we've got to tackle that, whether there's things that we can do using our own powers as a local authority. In terms of to address the issues of cars parking on curbs and stuff, what have you, buildings not accessible, all of those things. So with that in mind, I've created a position on cabinet for disability and disability alone, and Councillor Pam Thomas is taking up that position.
Can I just add my congratulations to Councillor Thomas? Councillor Thomas was an excellent assistant cabinet member, and she would be a brilliant cabinet member. We tried to do some things, didn't we, Councillor Thomas? Still an awful lot to do, and I wish her well with that work, and I'm sure Councillor Kempin's opening remarks will also similarly congratulate Councillor Thomas. Thank you.
You must be psychic,
because I was indeed going to do that. And congratulate the mayor, for that matter. This doesn't happen too often, but I think it is a wise move to have an appointment like that. It is too easy, whether we're on the planning committee or in any other parts of the council, to forget the specific problems of those who are physically disabled in whatever way. And I think having a cabinet member for that will challenge all of us to think more deeply about these issues. So I'm delighted to congratulate you, Councillor Thomas, on your appointment. But that's enough being nice, my old man. I did suggest to you when I brought 130 young people to the council chamber here and cheered you in that you would find it a better meeting perhaps than this one. But I just wanted two questions, if I might, to the mayor. I'm always interested when the mayor of Liverpool does like what all the old people do, goes down on a walk down memory lane, and we have these little selective impressions of what happened in the past and what didn't, and what an admirable brave man the mayor is to admit he has to use anagram apps these days to keep his brain active. I keep my brain active by listening to the mayor and thinking about what he says. So I'd just like to ask him a simple question. Which actually links the Pottery Festival and what he was saying about property. I, not being very good with computers, perhaps like the mayor, invited my 8-year-old granddaughter to look some information up for me. And I gave her two names, I could have put a third name. One was a property developer, which we sold a property to for £1. Another was a property developer, and I won't mention any names, we're not going to get into any legal difficulties, who we sold a big site to in Liverpool. And we could have gone a third one, Because I did this and managed to find out what my granddaughter did and have a look. The people that we entered into a relationship for the Hope and Glory Festival. And you know, in the two examples my 8-year-old granddaughter was able to do, she found people with an appalling track record with which this council should not have done business at all, never mind the transfer of assets. I wonder if you could tell me, Mr. Mayor, why if my 8-year-old granddaughter can do it, you couldn't, the assistant, the deputy mayor couldn't, the assistant mayor couldn't before he went off to help flood these things in China, on the whole of our own regeneration department.
Well, I mean, I just heard a statement there and a rabbit sitting there, a question. What was the question? It's sort of about his 8-year-old daughter.
Why it was not due diligence carried out properly while we were flogging off council assets cheaply?
Which due diligence and what council assets were we flogging off cheaply?
You just said
we sold the property for a pound. I assume you're talking about the homes for a pound.
No, you assume that I'm talking about the church in Rodney Street, St Andrew's Church.
Oh, right, right, right. And what would you have done in terms of trying to get it refurbished and done, or what did you do? You stopped the rock. Stop the rock was set up because of your administration. But what's your problem with that? Again, it's innuendo, smears with nothing. And you know what? This is a guy whose administration, you know, brought this city into disrepute. The then leader Storey had to resign because you paid £450,000 to the chief executive. This is an administration that was a laughing stock. That's why you were kicked out. This is a leader that left the headlines in the Echo that this was like Beirut. Our city's being left by Beirut. Not my statement, but his own statements. So you know, we've got your claim about the building in Rodney Street for a pound. That, again, that's something that, as far as we're concerned, we entered into in good faith and we went through the legal processes and it was all done above board. And if you've got anything to say to that, please say it public and I'll sue you because it did absolutely nothing. And what else are you talking about? What else did he mention? What was the other question he asked?
To the developers, which he was talking about before.
What he wanted to listen to his own comments. You sold the land to Avon Splash. Your administration in 2004, we took control in 2010. I think the senility and terms of the anagram test and stuff, whatever, it's you that needs to do them, not me. So I'm aware of the facts and hold them.
Okay, I mean, I think we can draw that one to a close. We'll call it a score draw, eh?
I'm not going to destroy anything further, and I will spare your instructions.
Right, we're going to move on to item 7, and not that, sorry, Councillor Crowe.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I move to the
members? Thank you, Councillor Dean, so I can't have my hand off for a question. Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'm also going to ask a question about the Chief Executive, but I will respect what you said about the email and those to the city solicitor. But I do want to raise the issue of Chinatown as well. The Mayor has attempted to blame Lib Dems for making bad decisions in the past. Characterised as a transaction between two private individuals. But I just don't think that washes. I don't think a development of this scale takes place in the city without some involvement, without some encouragement by the City Council. Something like this should never have got through due diligence. This decision should have been stopped because the potential issues should have been very easy to spot. They weren't, and the result has been mitigated.
Can I stop it?
Unmitigated desire. Just a little question, it's a very simple question. It's a very simple question, it's a specific question. Is the Mayor planning to change and improve council policies to ensure that the property development market in Liverpool becomes more reliable and trustworthy?
The markets in this city over the last 6 years has seen investments in excess of £7 billion. I've just told you that there's £1.5 billion planned for investment in the next 18 months. We've had interest from overseas developers. Last week, We met with people from Singapore, we met with people from elsewhere, we've got people from other countries talking to us about investments and development. And then if you try to smear the process by saying about due diligence, what is it you mean by due diligence? Could you explain that to me? Then I'll answer. What is it you mean by due diligence?
I presume the memo or due diligence is it's checking the background of people who are going to get involved.
So from our point of view, you want me, you want me to actually go and have council officers doing due diligence for any sale of any land or any property between one private sector company and another private sector company across the country? So what would you say to the company that sold this land to another company if I had said, I'm not happy with that? Do you think they would have took the extra £1.3 million that they got from that company rather than another company? How do you think that works?
My question was specific. We need to prevent these kinds of unmitigated disasters happening in Liverpool.
Listen,
we need is policy to prevent.
I want to prevent storm of hurricane Irma. I want to prevent us shouting. I want to prevent all of those things. But I live in the real world. I deal with the things I can do and try not to attempt wasting my time dealing with the things that I can't do. I've just said to you, but if you're telling me that as the mayor of this city, I could have stopped one private sector company selling to another private sector company when one private sector company was offering £1.3 million more than the other one, you're living in crowd pupil land. We're trying to pick up the pieces now to make sure that those people that have been hurt and stung to help them get through this, we're the ones taking this company to court. It's not, I can't, this has happened in other cities across the country, to try and create a smear that it's down to us and we should have stronger due diligence is nonsense. Our due diligence is fine, it was done. Yes, for the things that we can do, what we will do is make sure that we try to see if we can get more detail ourselves, even though we're not obliged to see if we can do it, because it's not good for Liverpool, it's not good for anybody, but the fact of the matter is that we did nothing wrong, and that's a simple fact, we did nothing wrong.
Thank you very much, everybody. We will move on. Just to clarify, I think what the mayor is saying, Councillor Crowe, is that we do due diligence when we sell land to somebody else. We don't do due diligence when a private company is selling land to Liverpool, because we have no powers in that matter. We are moving on to number 7, changes in committee memberships and appointments to outside.
Thank you, Lord. Can I move the changes to committees and outside bodies as outlined in Appendix A?
Is that agreed? Next item is nominations of local authority representative governors. Councillor Small.
Can I move the recommendation in relation to the nomination of local authority representative governors set out on pages 41 to 42 of the Council Chamber Council agenda?
Is that agreed? Okay, we're moving on to motions. So can I remind members in terms of the timing of speeches, the mover of the motion gets 5 minutes and has the right of reply also 5 minutes. All of the speakers get 3 minutes and 2 minutes for extensions if agreed by the council. Can I remind members to please indicate clearly if they wish to speak on a particular motion or amendment to enable me to make a note of the list of speakers. So we're going to move on to motion item number 9, which is the first motion on the agenda, moved by Mayor Anderson.
Well, I hope this motion is agreed and accepted. If it is, then we'll move on.
We'll move it
then
anyway.
Yes, we certainly support this, my old man. I don't think that those people people who said that the money spent on this, which if I remember rightly was 1.2 million, was wasted. If we took that attitude, we'd never try to get anything into the city. So we are content that it was money well spent. But the questions I've got, which I hope are supportive to the mayor, are did we get any feedback from the government as to whether or not they thought particularly weaknesses in our case that we could possibly deal with? And is he keeping the team together to try and do other things? So I think it was a very good and strong team. I know he's already talked about the Lido, but is that team going to become the ongoing campaign team, as it were?
Yeah, two things. The answer to whether there was any critique, if you like, of our being, we are responding, the minister has written to me, informed me, and we will be talking to them about the critique. The margin between ourselves and Birmingham was very, very small. Some of the things that they've said about our bid, we are challenging. Not that it'll do anything, but at least it needs to be challenged. One of the things that I was enormously proud of was not only Odunaiya and also Mike Kane and others that led the bid, but to have the team united, and not only the team in the City Council, but outside of the City Council work together. And I think if we show that enthusiasm and that passion, then we're in a good place as a city and we'll move forward. And there are things that we've got within that document and our bid that we can build on and use. And the other thing is, you're absolutely right, that we'll never ever share from taking risks. If you don't take risks, you don't share rewards and you don't benefit from rewards. And it was the right thing to do because it would have stimulated growth within North Liverpool. So once we get feedback from the session that we have with the Minister and their officials, we'll produce that report for City Council. Because there are one or two things in there that has been said that I will report back to the council on that I'm not happy, and the council then needs to make a decision on it. But yes, we will learn from that feedback, and we give it, as we always do, openly and transparently back to people to see.
Okay, I didn't see anybody else indicating, so we will move on. But just for correctness in the records, can I just check that the motion was formally seconded by somebody, Councillor O'Bannon, formally seconded. Therefore, that motion is agreed unanimously, and we move on to the next motion, to be moved by Councillor Small. My apologies, it's Councillor Lincroft, and seconded by Councillor Brown, I believe.
Lord Mayor, the wrong neck, don't worry. Thanks for the opportunity to propose this motion. We all here in this chamber take pride in our city, proud of our heritage, proud of our culture, proud of our very streets. And we know that the overwhelming majority of our residents take similar pride in where they live. But sadly, that sense of civic pride is not shared by everyone. There is a small minority of people who seem just not to care. They litter, they throw rubbish, they make mess. They refuse to clean up after their dogs, and they leave our streets dirty and unkempt. They seem to have no civic pride, Lord Mayor. Some people have bad habits. And worse still, some people profit by fly-tipping waste onto our streets, causing harm to the environment and costing the taxpayer hundreds of thousands of pounds to clean up their dumping. And how can it be right? At a time of extraordinary and unprecedented Tory government austerity, that this city must waste money in cleaning the casually discarded rubbish that is left. So news that the council and the police are using CCTV to secure convictions of fly-tippers and even the seizure and destruction of a van used in dumping waste. That should please us all. Tough action by this administration against environmental criminals. And it's not just the money that we spend centrally in this administration. Many ward councillors devote large parts of their mayoral neighbourhood funds to clean up days and skip programmes. And in Notting Ash, my ward colleagues and I started an initiative called Loving Dovey, an intensive clean-up programme, helping neighbours to clean up their front gardens and their hedges on a street-by-street basis. Action by ward councillors to tackle blight, and I know it's very common across this chamber. And as we learn from the British Medical Journal, it is not just the environmental blight that we must worry about. They show that dropped fan ends pose real health concerns, which should worry everyone. A serious threat, and to use their language, Lord Mayor, a serious threat to the health of humans and animals posed by discarded cigarette butts. And it's right that we take action to tackle this mess. My speaker's a former smoker myself. So, Lord Mayor, everyone should be able to take pride in where they live. And I welcome that this administration is taking real action to tackle litter, fly tipping and drop spots. And I call for more action, and indeed more imaginative action, to change people's bad habits, to keep our streets clean, to tackle dumping, and to restore that sense of civic pride. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
A staggering statistic is that of the 6 trillion cigarettes that are smoked globally every year, 4 trillion of them result in cigarette butts being discarded as items of litter. 50% of litter in the UK comprises of cigarette butts. Just in one year, 2011-2012, there was a 90% increase of the preponderance of discarded cigarette butts identified on our beaches in the UK. Many people fail to realise that cigarette butts are not some kind of biodegradable entity that will disappear like a banana skin or an apple core. They are made up of slivers of fine plastic. They are in a condition where they do not biodegrade over anything less than a couple of hundred years. They are contaminated with heavy metals, which come from some of the cigarettes themselves, cellulose, acetate, nicotine, and a variety of other toxic chemicals. The University of San Diego did a recent report which indicated that one cigarette butt in a litre of water is enough to provide enough toxicity to kill off all the marine life that would otherwise be able to survive within that litre of liquid. Lord Mayor, the preponderance and increasing preponderance of cigarette butts in litter, in this city in particular, but indeed nationally and globally, is a developing, first of all, blight on our communities, but also an increasing public health problem manifesting itself in knock-on implications in the marine environment, the local communities in which we currently live, and increasingly providing a form of toxic ingestive material for children and young people. It is only a local authority that fails to appreciate that public health problem that would refuse to applaud the increasingly assertive action taken by Liverpool City Council in dealing with this increasing problem of discarded cigarette butts. This council should be proud, I think, of the increasing intolerance of this antisocial behaviour of discarding cigarette butts without properly taking into it, without properly disposing of them. And in particular, not only does it present an emerging and increasing problem, but the health implications will be with us for generations down the line because of the length of time it takes for these cigarette butts to degrade. Consequently, Lord Mayor, we're doing exactly the right thing, and criticism that to a large extent has been restricted to a few loud voices and isn't widely shared in this community, but the criticism of the increased enforcement activity is profoundly misplaced in my view. doubles down on tackling antisocial behaviour, improves the health and well-being of our committee, and it raises much needed resources that can be used to clean up the problem. Thank you.
I thank the two members for some information, something I wasn't aware of, I'm grateful for it. I'm not speaking against the motion, but I just want to raise a concern I have about many of the motions we have in the council. The cost of doing something is the cost of what we don't do instead. And the reason I say that with a little anxiety is at the moment we still have phenomenal problems of builders dropping debris in entries. We're having a horrendous amount of time. Council officers trying to trace the builders with some support from the public, sometimes understandable residents. We're having a lot of problems of landlords, totally neglecting HMOs. I mean, I actually will name one because I got a little bit of evidence to back up any proceedings. 463 and 465 West Garby Road, we have literally a mattress or sofa dumped outside the flats there. We've had witness statements, not just myself as a local councillor, local residents in Clifton Road and Alton Road have given the council direct witness statements of tenants dumping the material on the ground. And only yesterday, these are photographs, the back of the site is totally overgrown and furniture is just mounding up. And there is an epidemic of rats as a consequence in the locality. Now, when I talk to residents about what is their priority about public health, a cigarette butt, or that neglect on the street on the high main road, I know what their priority would be in mind. The worry I have, and I'd ask the members to consider that, is if we take action on one element, have we got a priority on the scale of the impact on society, right? We're dealing with bigger problems that are more visible and more impacted, because there are parts of my world now that have an epidemic of rats because of real problems with a big connection. That's not the one, that's not preserving staff. I think some of the staff are very diligent. That may not all the case this time. We've got real problems with HMOs, we've got real problems with dumping, we've got real problems with abuse of builders and other developers who are not using the additional facilities we have built in the area. And against that, cigarette butts may not come on as the evident priority for prosecution when other things which are of greater impact need prosecuting. So I'm just saying that because we've got limited staff, we've got limited resources, we need to prioritise things. And I'm going to support the motion. I'm grateful for the moves, very important comments there, I'm grateful for all that. I've learned something today, but I'm just worried about are we hitting the more serious issues that have more detrimental impact with very limited enforcement capability.
Councillor Morgan.
Can I thank the movers of the motion for raising this important question, also for Councillor Bradford's question. I want to make an admission here. I have been accused on a number of occasions by the Liverpool Echo. I see the journalist isn't here, he's holidaying somewhere. So I can speak freely. I have been accused of using Gino to make money for the City Council by targeting smokers, innocent smokers like yourself, my Lord Mayor, who might be called. You would never, of course, be. To make money for the City Council. Guilty as charged. I'm really proud of the fact that we are targeting people who drop cigarette butts to make money that funds the kind of issues that Councillor Bradford raises. It's not a question of the wrong priorities, it's the right priorities to be able to fund enforcement. We don't have the money to fund enforcement. By targeting cigarette butts, and let's be absolutely clear, it's easier to catch smokers dropping fags on the ground than the only other form of literal dumping. Not only is it not cost, it delivers a profit. It's wrong. Why shouldn't we deliver a profit when that profit can fund exactly the kind of more high priority enforcement that Councillor Bradford says? So it's a fair question, Councillor Bradford, but the answer is that actually, by targeting drop cigarette butts, we can fund the more important enforcement in many people's eyes related to dog foul or builders waste or the other things. And we're making significant money out of this. So guilty as charged, something we should be proud of. It's real common sense to me. The second point is, and I'm indebted to a member of the public who sent us information about this, about the health impact of cigarette butts. I confess I haven't thought much about it. And actually, again today, I Googled cigarette butts and health, and I'd only read one article, but actually it's about 20 immediately come up online. And it's pretty serious stuff. And it is important to spell this out, actually. Well, although it's more visible, things like dog poo, right, actually cigarette butts are pretty serious. Firstly, they're not biodegradable. Secondly, they get into water supply in the way that, if you like, food dropped on the street doesn't, and other larger forms of rubbish don't. So they contribute to essentially cigarette butts are from plastic. Right. They don't degrade. So they make a massive contribution to the plastic content, particularly of the oceans and rivers. They're not a trivial environmental hazard. The other reason that they're dangerous to small children in particular and animals is because they're small. They get picked up and chewed and people can eat. So there's a double, there's a profound longer-term environmental impact. And actually a lot of other forms of dumping environmental hazards, although they're more offensive, are possibly not as long-term toxic. So that's the other reason for thinking about it. This is not a trivial point, it's not, oh, they're just dropping a pack. And let me say, as a smoker myself, right, there is not a problem if you are, I mean, I occasionally, my new group of friends, I'm sitting outside a watering house and I'm smoking, and I can't see an ashtray. It's your problem. You have a thing called a cigarette packet or a tin if you smoke tobacco. You still can have it on that and put it in there.
Son Victor, and in his bag were about 10 little, tiny little small parcels, each one containing a portable personal ashtray. I can tell you that the Lady Mayoress is making every effort to make sure she is not caught by Councillor Mumby.
Anyway, Councillor Warren.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. I am also concerned that the methods from cigarette butts pose a potential threat to our marine environment, and yes, I'm also concerned about the almost 5 trillion butts that are littered annually that contaminates our food chain. Cigarette butts discarded miles inland can end up in storm drains and eventually empty into our oceans or on our rivers. I do believe that this council, however, could and should enhance public awareness about the toxicity of discarded cigarette butts on children, animals, and the marine wildlife. I believe we should be providing information and clean-up days aimed at highlighting the seriousness of disposing cigarette butts responsibly, and they should not be discarded carelessly. Assist me, help to decrease the environmental hazards of those cigarette butts. As we know, and it's been mentioned, that cigarette butts are not biodegradable from the material that they're made from. But yesterday, my Lord Mayor, it was revealed that 13,689 fixed penalty tickets were issued by the Liverpool Litter Squad team, which is operated by Kingdom. Out of those 13,689 fines, 12,754 were handed